that was also led by people in prison, as well as California being broke and having this budget shortfall. That was the only facility that they built, even though they were trying to build more. And then they actually ended up shutting it down even before they opened it up. So then they put all this money into building this prison instead of putting it into things that people actually need. You know, it's big, it's pretty, it's brand new, state of the art, and they shut it down.
What does that say about
where the dollars are going to?
What are they
going to
do with it?
They just shut it down.
And it's just sitting there?
Yeah, it's just empty and it's just sitting there.
How much is it going to cost?
We don't know yet, but we really want to find that out, because that's something to ask the state. How are you going to build this prison and say that it's something that's good for communities without actually asking people who are from those communities what they need and what they want, and then shut it down? We just wasted a whole bunch of money that could have gone to so many other programs. Like, everything that Debbie listed off, everything that you all mentioned at the beginning of this meeting, like, those are what communities actually need, but they're not actually coming to communities and asking that stuff. They're kind of overriding communities, trying to push communities out, and then put something new in its place. That actually hurts us, right? So, also this summer, the state announced that it would release 3,000 people under what it's calling the Alternative Custody Program. So this basically allows people who are in women's prisons and men's prisons who have short sentences to basically go home to their families and their communities and finish out their sentences at home. But since that announcement, less than 20 people have been approved for release under this program. And far people have actually been released. So they're saying that there's 3,000 people possibly that could be approved for this, but they're putting a whole bunch of barriers in the way. So they're saying, oh, you need medication, we can't release you onto the street. That could look like, I have asthma and I need an inhaler to manage my asthma, and because of that, the state won't send me home even though it says that I pose no risk and that I actually could go home. So that's the kind of thing that they're putting in people's way in order to be able to access this program that could actually help to not open up this new facility that they're trying to open up in Folsom. It's actually at a men's prison and they're trying to open up a women's wing to it. But what we're saying is release more beds than one that already exists, and you won't need to open up more beds, just like we tried to do down at Live Oak and then shut it down and waste all this money. So a couple more things from this statement that just kind of give a little bit more background as to what people are experiencing on the inside. So they say the state has begun packing those of us in the remaining prisons together to make room for thousands of people from Valley State Prison for women to be transferred in. Such cramped quarters create conditions ripe for epidemics of communicable diseases common in prisons, such as tuberculosis and MRSA. Cells at Central California Women's Facility were designed for 4 women but are housing 8 and are now beginning to house 10. Older women at California Institution for Women were forced to give up their lower bunks to make room and now risk falls and injury. There is not enough space to ensure women will not be housed with people or staff with whom they have documented safety concerns. Women are being coerced into signing waivers of liability, consenting to being housed with people who may pose them grave bodily harm. Alternatively, some women are being told they will be held in isolation indefinitely for their own protection, a measure usually only undertaken as punishment. So this is like segregating people from the main grounds and putting them in isolation for 23 hours a day. This poses a great risk to people's mental health. So with budget cuts, most educational vocational programs have already been eliminated from the women's prisons, taking with them most of our prisoner jobs. Now with the conversion, we face increased unemployment within the prison system, rendering us unable to buy basic toiletry and sanitary supplies. Another concern is the elimination of peer support groups that also would harm the local prison town community of Chowchilla and Farimead. So they're saying that here at VSPW, our threatened self-help groups have annually organized fundraisers inside the prison. Together, we rose over $225,000 from donations and fundraisers that support local public schools in these prison towns, primarily migrant, Latino, Native American, and African American families accessing schools, an ethnic breakdown that parallels our population here on the inside. The money we raise is to ensure children have jackets and shoes. Our thinking is, if we cannot clothe or take care of our own children, we will do all we can from behind these walls to help other mothers take care of their young. We are not heartless women. Please do not take away our opportunity to try to repair harms and serve our communities. So they're asking people from these communities to join in with their struggle. Not only is there no rehabilitation in California Department of Corrections rehabilitation, There isn't even the baseline for medical provisions that we need to survive. Alternatives to prison are effective and inexpensive. The state claims thousands can be released from women's prisons. They make empty promises we wish they would fulfill. In the meantime, our children wait. We inside cannot vote. We cannot lobby Sacramento. How many of us will pay with our lives while we wait for relief? How many women will have nervous breakdowns? How many will die due to lack of care? We need you to demand that the state halt its conversion program and begin a release program. And finally, it says, the state should focus on identifying and implementing means for reducing the prison population and ensuring savings are reinvested in education and services for our communities so that we can all thrive. When the population in fact reduces and we are home, then and only then, Valley State Prison for Women should be closed and repurposed. Repurposing or closing means the space can no longer be used as a prison. Not a prison for the men of our communities, not a prison for anybody. Going home does not mean going to another prison or a county jail or a locked treatment program or a new gender responsive program. Home means home. So, thank you all. With that, I will hand it over to Siobhan Brown, our legal fellow at Justice Now.
Good evening, everybody. I'm not I was once incarcerated for almost 8 years, and I started advocating for Justice Now. I've been with them for 7 years now. And and by being inside there and seeing the hardship and the trauma and the abuse and the effects of being incarcerated, I feel a memorial should be placed there. So that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Before I ask this, does anybody have any questions?
So have you started moving women over to the other prison then?
Yes, they have started. We get movement sheets from people inside about once a week, and they have started moving people. They already moved all the pregnant people from BSPW either over to CCWF or down south in LA to CIW.
So with the, and I was telling Debbie the last time we had a board meeting that, you know, I try to stay up with some things. Some things, honestly, I don't understand. I can't comprehend it. So, I thought there was a lawsuit or something put in place where they weren't going to close the prison.
Yeah, so the city of Chowchilla filed a lawsuit against the California Department of Corrections to stop the conversion of the from women to men's prison. So their position is that if we're gonna lose the women's population here, they don't want to see a conversion. They just want to see it shut down. They would rather see it shut down than, you know, have another prison. And they're finally, you know, faced with a struggle that a lot of different rural communities in the Central Valley are dealing with. Delano has dealt with this issue. I mean, not specifically a conversion issue, but once you allow a prison to come into your county, and in Delano, they had a Delano 2 prison, and you don't want that second prison, or you don't want an expansion of that prison, you have no say-so. The county has no say-so, because then it becomes the California Department of Corrections, their property, their deal, and what the community wants, or whatever the brokers that the community is trying to gain from that, are left out. And we see that issue all up and down the 99, that problem.
What's the status of that lawsuit? Are they going to make a decision?
So in September, I don't have the exact date. In September, they're going to make a decision on whether the California Department of Corrections are mandated to hold public hearings. So where the community will have a chance to talk about Farimead. Talk about the needs of Farimead and protest, the conversion. So we have this small window of time between now and September, mid-September, to make our